This podcast is brought to you in part by the support of the AMTV patrons. Thank you. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to AMTV Radio, the podcast where I'm joined by a very special guest each time, and we talk about, well, whatever we want to, really. And for today's guest, I'm joined by someone who, in the creative sense, has pretty much done everything the industry has to offer. She is an actor, a director, a writer, a singer, a producer, practically everything. Introducing Helen Goldwyn. Helen, thank you for coming on.
Oh, it's a pleasure. It's always very flattering to be asked. So, yeah, now I'm looking forward to it.
As am I. I'm looking forward to having a big old chat about a lot of your work. I'm sure some of you listening or watching will know Helen's name from stuff she's done for Big Finish Productions, a lot of Doctor Who, amongst other things. But where I wanted to start, Helen, I wanted to go way back, right to the beginning, when you were a young wee lass. What inspired you, or what was the spark to get you into acting or performing? Because everyone's got a different story, haven't they?
Well, it's very cheesy, really. I remember being very young. I must have been about five. Mm. And I was sitting in the car with my mum, and the branches in the trees were moving in the wind. And I said to her, "I want to dance like the branches in the trees." And so she started me on ballet lessons, mm-hmm. and then I started doing all the different types of dance. So, I mean, dance was my very first love. Okay. I thought I was going to be, because I went to ballet school, professional ballet school from the age of 12, mm. Until 19. I did 3 hours of dancing, you know, professional dance training a day, mm. 7 years. But I think all of it is an expression of music. Even drama is an expression of music, mm. that underlies everything that I do. And just to become someone different. I never wanted to play myself. I wanted to be all these different characters.
Yeah. Oh, that's a great, I'm sure not many people knew it started in ballet, because from what I understand about ballet, I'm not a dancer at all. I've got two left feet as far as I'm concerned. But from what you hear about ballet or dance in general, it's quite the intense profession, is it not? Like, especially when you're training for that many hours a day.
Yeah, I would say we were all obsessive compulsive about it, and mm. quite masochistic as well, because when you're dancing, doing point work on your toes, mm. really it's painful.
Yeah.
and actually we were kind of addicted to the pain of it as well. Mm. I mean, I really thought I was going to be a dancer. And I think over the years, I realized that although I had a feel for dance and I was obviously musical, I just didn't have the natural physical facility for it. Mm-hmm. You've got to have a certain kind of beautiful aesthetic line. Your legs need to be perfectly straight. You need to have high insteps. And I never had that. And I wasn't naturally supple. So I had to push myself so hard. Mm. And I almost feel like I used up my energy in terms of dance. You know, I don't push myself physically like that anymore. Yeah. I feel like I did enough.
I feel like I never did for dance. The cha-cha slide was about the best I could muster back when I was younger, and that was about it. So.
Well, that's enough. More than most.
Yeah, after a few drinks especially, it is, yes. But so after dancing, as you say, when you hit 19, you sort of stopped mm. doing that as intensely. What was it that sort of sparked you to move into more like acting and singing, if you like?
Well, I'd already started that at 16. I had started the musical theatre course at Arts Educational. So I did the ballet course and then I did the musical theatre course. So the singing and the acting were very, you know, strongly present. Mm. And actually what I loved most about singing was the acting through song.
Yeah.
And I almost felt restricted by being a dancer. If you say you're a dancer and you go for an audition, you'll end up in the ensemble. And if you can act as well, then you'll be the understudy.
Yeah.
Because it's so useful to have someone like that who can do all of it. And actually, my usefulness worked very much against me mm. at the start of my career. And eventually, I didn't admit that I could dance. I would put on my application that I could move.
Yeah. That's a good, I'm going to start doing that on my CV. Yeah. I can move. I can't.
I can move a bit. Because as soon as you say you're a dancer, you are, with acting credits on your CV, you're an understudy. And yeah. I was an understudy for 7 years. You know, I just couldn't get out of it. I was way too useful for my own good.
It's funny how that works, isn't it? Because you'd think the ability to dance and act would sort of, in a way, as you say, like set you for not necessarily always being the understudy. It's a weird way that the industry puts you like that, isn't it? I mean,
yeah. Well, there's the other element that has played a very significant part in my career, and that is that the industry rotates around casting type. Mm. You know, your look. Do you fit an archetype? Do you fit, you know, into these categories that we expect from leading ladies and sidekicks and comedy characters? And I quite patently didn't. Mm. You know, I was average Joe. I was 5'4", white, middle class, brown hair, blue eyed, not very exciting to look at, you know, nothing special physically about me, which was great as a blank canvas for a character actor. But when you're 19, 20, you know, people don't want a character actor. So my first job was in Uncle Vanya, actually, a fantastic production of Uncle Vanya with Kenneth Branagh's company, Renaissance Theatre Company. And I understudied all three lead women. Mm. So one of them is a plain Jane who can't get a man. And the other one is a total man trap, like a honeypot, and the men are all around her. Mm. And the third one was Uncle Vanya's mother. And so that should have told me at that stage of my career that I am none of these things, but all of them, you know.
Did you ever get a chance to play all three, or...?
No, one can dream, can't we?
Yes,
I did get to do it in the rehearsal, and Richard Briers played Uncle Vanya.
Oh, wow.
So I did act opposite Richard, and that was amazing.
Yeah.
But no. I
noticed on, because I had a look at your website just to, you know, see what you'd done, what you put on there. And when you scroll down your list of acting credits, you've worked with some recognisable names, shall we say. I mean, Judy Dench being one of them. I mean... Tell us what that was like, working with Judy Dench.
Well, I always tell this story because it was so surreal for me. I mean, initially, when you start rehearsals, you think, oh, that's Judy Dench. And then after a day, you forget all that. And it's just a fun director who is, you know, doing a job, and you're just all part of a company. But she was doing a play in the West End at the time. Mm. And I can't remember what it was called. And myself and another recent graduate, I was 21, Judy said, oh, do you want to come and see the play? I can get you house tickets, you know, really good tickets. And afterwards, you can come backstage and have a glass of champagne and see me. And so we drove in her chauffeur-driven car from the theatre where we had been rehearsing or performing. And then we went to her theatre where she was starring in this play. And we sat there and watched this incredible performance where we both went, oh my god, it's Judy Dench. That's Judy, that's, you know, that person we're working with, that's that incredible enigma on stage. And then of course when we went backstage to see her in her dressing room, I couldn't speak.
Bless you.
Well, I'd been laughing and joking with her up to that point, and then afterwards when I had had it hit me in the face what a talent she was, I couldn't speak to her in the same way again.
It's so funny, isn't it? Because I remember when I graduated from drama school in 2017, and one of my friends was very lucky to go into a show that went straight into a big tour in the West End. It was the musical The Band, the Take That one.
She was one
of the five younger girls. And, you know, I was dead happy for her, got to see her, it was great. And then I saw her at one point, and at first I was like, why am I being weird around you? It's like, you're the same person I saw every day for 3 years, but now you're like this, you're this big star, you know? And she was like, oh, don't be daft. She was like, it is funny, like, when you see someone, I guess, you work with in that environment, how it sort of makes you go, whoa, okay, like, this is something else.
But as a general rule, I would say I'm not impressed by celebrity, you know. I think because I know that the industry is so oversubscribed, and I know so many unbelievably talented people who just didn't get their break. So yes, if you're a celebrity, yes, I'm sure you've worked hard and I'm sure you've honed your craft, but you were also lucky.
yes,
in a way
absolutely.
That, you know, others of a similar talent weren't. So,
yeah,
you know, unless you're doing something remarkable with that celebrity, it doesn't really impress me.
Yeah, I think that's sort of what, at least when I, and I'm not sure about yourself, but when I started training in 2014, they sort of said that from the off. The first day they sat us down and went, look, you know, we'll help facilitate your skills, we'll help train you, we'll give you opportunities to perform in plays of this, that and the other, but they were like, this is not a one-way guarantee for success. And I think as an 18-year-old, I know I appreciated that, just hearing that off the bat, so you get all that preconceived notions out of your head. I mean, was it the same for you at Arts Ed, or was it more just focusing on the work itself?
It was very lacking in that kind of advice, actually. We were literally trained up, like, you know, singing, dancing, acting machines, and we knew our craft, but we didn't know anything about living in the real world. You know, how to pay your bills, how to earn money in between work, how to get do your tax, how to sustain yourself emotionally when you're being rejected and rejected. You know, that was lacking then. I know it is very much part of the course at Arts Ed now. It's integral. But what you also don't get as an actor, and I deliver courses on this as often as I can, is an understanding, I'm sure you do in modern times, an understanding of the fact that you are a brand, you are a product. You know, I could never find my brand when I started out. I didn't want to be pigeonholed, but actually you have to allow yourself to be, have to, because there are too many people. And you have to stand out as something very specific, and you have to know how to sell that, and you have to have that brand go through everything on social media, on the photos that you use, you know, and actors need to understand that talent is just one small component of success, unfortunately.
That's it really, isn't it? And I mean, I remember I trained with a lad who, he had a very sort of, if you like, classic look about him, very World War One, World War Two era. He had quite a well-spoken accent, and, you know, he was always being cast as like the posh boy. And at first he was like, why am I always being, you know, the posh boy? But then I think, as you say, he sort of, he understood, he's like, right, well, if that's my casting type. And that's what he's done a lot of that since graduating, but it's got him work, you know, it's helped him bump up the credits.
And contacts.
Yeah.
It's contacts. So I did a Christmas show at Chester Repertory Theatre, Chester Rep, and I played a really over the top baddie in a children's Christmas
show. The best
show,
kind right? of
at the
characters.
End of, yeah, at the end of every scene, I go, what? And I got on very well with the director, Deborah Shaw, who was usually doing very highfalutin Shakespearean productions. And she decided to do a Christmas show for fun. And about a year later, I had an email from Deborah saying, would you like to play the lead in High Society?
Yes, please. And,
yes, please. Yeah. But I would never have been even seen for that role. It was just because she knew me, she liked me, she liked my work ethic, she knew I was versatile. I didn't have to audition. She just offered it to me.
Yeah.
So that's kind of how it works. You have to get in and then diversify.
Yeah, it is absolutely. Aspiring actors listening or watching, take notes. This is very valuable and very realistic information as well from two people who are doing it still. So
yes, exactly.
But just to focus on stuff you've created, I noticed again from what you've put on your website, you've helped either like write or direct, star in, produce one woman shows. What is it about for you, like one-woman performances? Because I mean, you know, a lot of people say, right, you're going to do a one-person show, it's just you, and they go, oh god, like I've got to sustain you know, I've got to sustain that for an hour or whatever it is. Do you like the first time you did it, was it that daunting feeling, or were you like, oh, this will be like a good challenge in a way?
Well, I always embrace challenge and something that scares me and that I haven't done before, so that's always a prerequisite for everything that I take on. But the one woman thing, I think because I was always, although I lacked confidence about the way I looked, and justifiably, because, you know, evidenced by my career, my look didn't work for me, but I had a huge amount of confidence in my ability. And that I never lost that. And so, yeah, I just wanted to be challenged. And I had a lot of rage and frustration in everything that I did, because I couldn't get seen for work.
Yeah.
And I think this is a thing that people don't understand about the acting industry. They think you get seen for loads of auditions and you get rejected.
Yeah.
You don't. You
if
don't
only.
Get through the door.
If
yeah.
Only.
And I tried so hard. I worked so hard. I wrote hundreds and hundreds of letters and I knocked on doors and yeah. I crashed auditions. And all my peers who were much more conventionally kind of leading lady looking were getting auditions left, right and centre. And I couldn't achieve that. So that rage and that frustration fueled this alternative creativity. I was, it was a kind of like a, you know, a middle finger up to the establishment, really.
We all love a bit of that from time to time,
yeah.
don't we?
So... But to answer a bit of your earlier question, was it daunting? I did my one woman show as the second half of a program. The first half was the play that I wrote for Louise Jameson.
Yes.
Pulling yeah. Faces. Mm. So I had written a one woman play for her with lots of input from her, of course. Mm. And then the second half was my musical theatre show, me singing songs from the shows. So it was like the Helen Goldwyn night at the Hackney Empire.
I like it.
Of course, nobody had ever heard of me. You know, everyone's like, who the hell is Helen Goldwyn? And it, as I drove to the theatre to do this show and to watch my play, which is also very nerve-wracking in front of an audience,
yeah.
I started having a panic attack,
like
a proper full-on, why am I doing this? Why have I done this to myself? Why?
No.
And I phoned up an old college friend who had never heard me in that state before, and I had to pull over on the hard shoulder and he had to talk me down.
Oh man.
to calm me down. And then of course I did the show and had the best night of my life.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. I completely can, you know, sympathize with that, because I've again had mates who've either written stuff for the first time that's getting performed, and it is, isn't it, it's like right before it starts, it's all those thoughts of but what if they don't like it, what if it goes wrong, what if this, what if,
yeah.
And it all, it's overwhelming, isn't it, because it all just comes at you at once and your head's like,
yeah.
What is happening now? So
yeah, why have I done this to myself?
Yeah.
And it's exposing of your creativity, your desire for success. It's all ego based as
yeah.
well. And what I never wanted to feel was embarrassed or undignified or humiliated. But of course, you have to put yourself in those vulnerable positions
yeah.
to even have a chance of success.
Exactly.
It's a clash all the time.
Yeah, that was the one thing that was drilled into us in training. Be comfortable with the uncomfortable. That was it. And
yeah.
I was like, well,
yeah.
yeah, you have to be, I suppose, because if you show signs of being like, ooh, then, you know, it doesn't get you far, does it? But
no.
I mean, you already mentioned Pulling Faces with Louise Jameson, which, of course, when it came out, was a big success. It toured for quite a while, didn't it? 2011 and 2012, if I've got my
facts
right.
It went to quite a few venues and had lots of outings. It's also been shown in Chicago and...
International.
A couple of other American venues. It was... You know, just one of those amazing opportunities. Not only was it a creative joy, it cemented this very valuable friendship that I have with Louise. She's one of my dearest, most valued friends.
Yeah.
And I feel so unbelievably privileged to have her in my life.
And she's a wonderful actress as well. I mean, I think Pulling Faces is still available for download on the Big Finish website, actually, I think.
Yes, because we did record it as an audio drama. Yes, it's still available.
Yeah. So anyone who didn't see it at the time, who's curious, head over to Big Finish and you will find it there. And again, like it was so funny making notes for this, because you've done so much and your career is so varied. So I thought if I picked everything, we'd be here for hours and hours. But just to touch on the singing side of things, of course, because as you say, you are a singer. There's clips of you singing available on your website as well. And you performed with the Piccadilly Orchestra, was it?
The Piccadilly Dance Orchestra.
That's the one, yeah.
Yeah. So in between acting work, I had a regular gig with we call it the PDO, at the Savoy Hotel on a Saturday night. It was a dinner dance, very posh, very expensive dinner dance event. And I did that off and on for 10 years.
Nice.
So we had a repertoire of over 100 songs. And because obviously the musicians would have their music with them, but I wasn't allowed music.
Oh.
So sometimes the band leader would say, let's do Thanks for the Memory. And I think, well, I don't know the I don't know what the lyrics are for that. And then the overture would start, and then I'd open my mouth and just trust that the words would come out.
As long as they rhyme, you're all right.
Yeah.
I know, yeah. I've done that. It's anyone listening, it's not advisable, but in the moment, if you're panicking, my head is, as long as it rhymes and it makes some sort of coherent sense, then it should be all right. Because at a dinner dance, you know, some people, they'll be drinking or eating. Only those who are looking at you going, are those the
Do you know, I did a contract, just one contract for 7 months as a singer on a cruise ship for P&O Cruises, which is where I met my husband, but that's a whole other story. And I was thrown on at the last minute to replace someone who dropped out.
Okay.
So I didn't have enough rehearsal time, and they put me on stage to sing a medley of show tunes. And I had to sing a song called Look What Happened to Mabel, which is a patter song. See that fascinating creature with perfection stamped on every feature. She was playing little Sally, the thing from the alley, or whatever.
Yeah.
And I couldn't. I started the song. See that fascinating creature. Dee 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 dee. And I couldn't get off it. I did the whole song. Da 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 da. Look what happened to Mabel. Dee 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 dee.
But hey, actors have to improvise, right? And that was, you know, you.
Oh Lord! Well, I was known as Dee Dee from then on. That was my nickname.
I think that's the thing about, I guess, especially with things like cruise ships. Once you get a thing where you can be nicknamed, that's it. Then you're stuck with that for the rest of the run.
That's it. Yeah.
I mean, I've not ever done a cruise ship before, but I know a lot of friends who have. And I think, just to touch on it briefly, I think, to my view anyway, cruise ships to some extent still have this sort of stigma about them. It's like, oh, once you're on it, you're on it, that's it then, or
It is very easy to get stuck, because what happened to me was I did my 7 month contract and I immediately got offered another one.
Yeah.
And when you're struggling financially,
yeah,
and you've just come back from the Caribbean, you know, you've been in the Caribbean for 3 months, and someone says, "Do you want to do all that again?" Most people will say yes.
Yeah.
But I was a bit crazy and super ambitious, so I said no. And I think I was unemployed for months afterwards.
But it is hard, isn't it? Especially with things like, I think cruise ships are some of the hardest things to take into account in that respect. Because like you say, the contracts are always so long, like 6 months minimum. And I guess when you're planning that out in your life, it's like, I've just done that for 6 months. Is it necessarily what I want to do again? And if you've got family or friends and it's all that, you know. But I'd be curious to try it.
I would highly recommend at least one contract to everyone. It was the incredible... most incredible experience.
Yeah.
I sailed around the planet, you know, we did a world cruise. I sailed into Sydney Harbour and I got paid to go ashore and have fun all day and then come back and do the show.
The best kind of jobs.
Yeah.
Oh, incredible.
What's not to love?
Exactly. Well, I think we'll use that as a segue to talk about sort of your history and story with Big Finish, if you like, which I'm sure some listeners of this show who are especially Doctor Who fans will know your name from that. And again, I only got into really listening to the audio dramas in the past year through the lockdown and all that sort of stuff. It's funny how, you know, I think the first ones I heard of yours were the stuff you'd either directed or written. But then I went back to the early stuff in the main range. And there you are again. So you've run the whole gamut. So So what got you started with Big Finish then? How did you sort of pop up on their radar?
Well, as with most lucky breaks, it was connections. You know, I had never heard of it. I didn't know anything about it. I didn't even understand what it was that I had turned up to do on the first day. It was because I was friends with Barnaby Edwards and Nick Pegg. I had done Macbeth on tour with Barnaby, and I had done a panto with both of them subsequently. And then Barnaby just contacted me one day and said, "You want to play a really small character, just one scene in this Doctor Who audio drama?" And I was like, "Okay,
sure, why not?"
Yeah. And then I turned up. Of course, it was Colin, wasn't it? It was Colin Bateman, Spectre of Lanyon Moore. And, you know, we had our Brigadier and we had Susan Jameson and, you know, all these familiar faces. And obviously I just loved it. I got killed by goblin aliens or something. And then I wrote to Gary Russell, who was the producer at the time. I emailed him and I said, I absolutely loved every second of that. I don't care what you cast me as. I don't care if I make a fool of myself. I have zero inhibitions. I will do whatever silly voices you want me to do. And he took me at my word and cast me as aliens for years afterwards. I mean, I've played so many aliens.
Because, I mean, looking at the credits as well, I mean, you appeared as an actor in, again, some of the earlier stuff like Storm Warning, Sword of Orion, Minuet in Hell, Blood Tide. And the one of the early adventures that you appeared in that I listened to recently and I adored it was Doctor Who and the Pirates, the sort of musical extravaganza. Yes. And I had no context that that was coming halfway through. So, you know, you listen to it and you're like, oh, yeah, this is like Doctor Who does the Pirates. Then all of a sudden Colin Baker starts singing. And then you all start singing. I thought, this is great.
So. It was genius. It was so bold and such an innovative thing to do. And Colin is so great at all that as well. It was such a platform for his musical skills. That was a highlight. That was a brilliant experience.
I mean, I am the very model of a modern major general is a difficult song anyway.
Yes.
And then when he's got all those different lyrics to throw in, I thought, my God, this must have been. I mean, did he do it all in one take or did it take a few goes to get it done?
I can't remember, but what we did have was 2 days rehearsal, which we never, ever have. Mm. Not before or since have I rehearsed for a big finish.
Yeah.
So that was unique. You know, and we had a musical director. We had the amazing Tim Sutton doing the musical direction and arrangement. So, yeah, it was a unique experience at Big Finish.
Mm. So, and when they cast you for that role in Doctor Who and the Pirates, were they aware you could sing, or was it a big surprise? You just sang, and they were like, "Wow, we didn't."
No, they knew. They knew.
Yeah.
I don't quite know how they knew. They did know.
They've got their agents, Big Finish. They're everywhere.
Yes. So, yeah. Fingers in every pie.
Yeah. But no, if anyone hasn't heard Doctor Who and the Pirates, please go and listen to it. It's an experience you'll never forget for many reasons. But then, of course, you've not just only acted in Big Finish. As I said at the beginning, you've done so many other roles. And one I wanted to talk to you about specifically was some of the stuff you've written, including this old thing, Subterfuge, which came out in the last year. Sylvester McCoy, Ian McNeice, Rufus Hound. So, Was that an idea, the whole Churchill 1945 vibe, was that an idea that was sort of pitched to you by Big Finish? Or
yes, that those elements were prescribed to me, that it needed to be set just before the first general election after the war, and that the monk was there to meddle with the outcome. But from that point onwards, everything else, I had to fill in the gaps. Yeah. And I must say, I've had terrible writer's block on a couple of occasions with Big Finish, and that one was one of them, where there were so many elements, there was so much to take on board and so much research. And then I sat for a week and thought, I can't, I don't know what to write.
Yeah.
I don't know who the, you know.
Who is everybody?
It was so hard,
Yeah.
And in the end, I used the post-it note method, which I hadn't used before. I just wrote all the incidents and I put them all in order, you know, all over the table, and kind of took it from there.
Yeah. The historicals, I imagine they must be quite a sort of different beast to write, because of course when you're dealing with any part of history, like you say, you've got to do that extra research to make sure, what was Churchill's speech like? Did he say this? Where did he stand for? Did that sort of add on top of that pile you were talking about? Sort of, I've got the sort of writer's block, but now I've also got history to deal with, you know?
So, I mean, I remember years ago thinking, I was quite envious of a friend of mine who had to do lots of research for a Mike Lee film that she was in, the Topsy Turvy. Mm. And it was, she had to research her character and everything about Gilbert and Sullivan. And I remember thinking, I'd like to do that. Little did I know.
Yeah. And then you get tasked with it.
But at least now we have the internet. My goodness, I don't know what I would do without that.
But
no, I enjoy it. And I'm very pedantic. I want it to be accurate, and I want it to be, you know, a strong representation of who that historical character really was.
Yeah.
And that's why I made Churchill not quite as sympathetic as he has been in some others.
Sure.
Finish.
Yeah.
I wanted him to be slightly sexist as he was in that era, and
Yeah, you know, he's quite the controversial liberal figure when you get to like the nuts and, I guess, the nuts and bolts of who he was. But one part of the story I quite liked in a way, and that, spoilers for anyone who hasn't listened to it, I'll put a time code in somewhere if you want to skip. But the ending, I kind of liked how it was, because a lot of Doctor Who adventures either sort of, you know, they've solved whatever it is and they're off in the TARDIS and da-da-da-da-da, title sequence. Whereas with this one, I kind of liked it was sort of a bit more downbeat, you know, Churchill sort of turning his back on this version of the Doctor, because from what we've heard so far, you know, they're all he's great mates with a great many of them. Yeah. But I kind of liked how you took that sort of, no, like he wouldn't just brush aside that the Doctor basically cocked up the election for him. He'd take that very much on the chin and turn his back on him. So it was just did that feel like the natural end in a way, as opposed to, say, you know, Sylve getting back in the TARDIS and taking off?
You have to go with the truth of the journey, really. And in essence, the Doctor is hoodwinking Churchill throughout for the greater good, for the sake of this fixed point in history. But Churchill demanded loyalty from people, and it wouldn't have made sense for him to forgive him. He would have felt terribly betrayed. So yes, you just have to go with the natural character journey, really.
Yeah. And what was it like working with Rufus Hound, who is currently at the time of recording wowing us on Dancing on Ice? Yeah.
Every time I talk to David Richardson, I think I'm recording a couple of things with Rufus in the near future. And David keeps saying, oh, well, when he's finished Dancing on Ice. And it just makes me laugh every time. Talking about that, when's Rufus available? When he's finished dancing,
when he's finished
on ice.
Skating, yeah.
Bless him. Well, I'll be honest, I didn't get to see Rufus recording. In fact, I didn't get to the recording at all for that for that drama. I was so busy, and then I heard it for the first time when we got the CD in the post.
Wow.
So that was exciting.
Yeah. No, he's such a charismatic, like, you're hooked on him, aren't you? Whenever he speaks, he's got such an energy about him, such a vibe about him. And it's strange looking back, because I think Subterfuge actually came out just before the world ended, shall we say. So it's quite, it was quite surreal for, like, looking back on the Big Finish website, seeing like, oh, March 2020. I was like, those were the days. Those were the steadfast days. But what's it like, I'm not asking to divulge into anything now, of course, spoilers, but what is it like recording now, I suppose, in this, you know, this lockdown environment where we can't really be with each other?
Well, I mean, it's amazing how we managed to keep going at first, because we were really finding our feet. For the first few weeks, we didn't break stride. We just kept on recording what we said we were going to record, but initially we were using Zoom, which kind of meant it was a bit unreliable in terms of the sound quality, but it was great to be able to see the actors. And then we changed to a system called Clean Feed, where we have a sound engineer in a central studio. We all dial in on our Clean Feed links, and it's all audio only. So nobody can see each other. And so it's incredibly clear, and it does work, but it's a different kind of energy. It's so hard to, you know, to do a full day of directing like that is so intense.
Yeah.
It's intense at the best of times, but it's just so hard when it's just coming through your ears and you can't see anyone. But, you know, you'll listen to the audios and you'd never know they were done.
Oh, completely. Yeah, I listened to a Peter Davison one the other day, Shadow of the Daleks, I think. And in the little behind the scenes, he talks about how they recorded it in lockdown. But I sort of sat back and thought, I would have never have guessed it was recorded, you know, with everyone in their bedrooms, you know, in their dressing gowns or whatever. But
well, except they're not in their bedrooms. This is what's funny, is that people are literally in their wardrobe or in the cupboard under the stairs or wrapped in duvets in the attic. You know, sometimes I had one actor the other day who literally had a duvet over her head. So every time she went to the computer to you know, label up the file, because everyone's recording on their home system as well as a backup, then we had to wait for her to get back under her blanket, you know.
It's honestly, I mean, it's incredible, as you say, how the audio world has been able to continue through these means.
Yeah.
But yeah, people, I think some people don't realise the lengths people have to go to get that quiet sound and stuff. And I think you're right on the intensity as well. My partner at the minute, at the time we're recording this, is doing a acting project, but it's 8-hour days over Zoom. And I think, you know, some people say, oh, that's quite easy, you know, you sit there and you're on. But I mean, staring at a screen for the best part of the day, it's by the end you're like, like, you know, it's
it really is draining. I mean, for in any business that's working online, it's a completely different sort of part of the brain that's engaged with on-screen stuff. And I'm really so looking forward to seeing actors in person again. You know?
Me and you both, and, trust me.
Yeah. And actually, I'm not a very theatrical person. I'm not kissy or huggy, or I've always been a bit like, are we going to kiss? I don't know you. But now I think I'm just going to be all over everyone.
Yeah.
That's when we're allowed to be.
Yeah. We've all missed each other after so long. Yes. Yeah. It's, it's crazy. But I think the industry, I mean, as you say, from Big Finish, it has this incredible tendency to just adapt. I mean, I did a Christmas show, a pantomime, but it was all drive-in theatre, so no one left their cars. It was all tuning into the radio. And just being on a stage again, I sort of, obviously it's Christmas and it's very fulfilling anyway, because, you know, you're giving kids that Christmas feeling. Yeah. But it feels even more so now, because you sort of think, this, if this was any other way, this wouldn't have happened, you know, it couldn't have happened. So the industry's, it's one of the many wonderful things of the industry, isn't it? That adaptation, if you like. But
I suppose so. I mean, I hope maybe that online theatre will be available in future. I think there are lots of people that can't get to the theatre for whatever reason. Mm. And it would be great if we carry on that new thing where you can buy a ticket to watch it online.
Yeah. I was enjoying I was enjoying the before the world ended, certain cinema screenings, because, you know, for some National Theatre or RSC, there were sometimes I'd be down there and I could see it, but then other times I found it quite, I know it's very, you know, 50-50 debate, and some people say, oh, it's great, and some people say, oh, no, it's terrible, it's ruining theatre. But I think in terms of accessibility, it's a great idea.
Yeah. I went to see Funny Girl at the cinema, starring Sheridan Smith, and I'm really glad I saw it at the cinema, because I could see that every nuance of her performance, and that wouldn't have been the case in the theatre.
The top row at the back of the back of the circle.
I really enjoyed seeing the subtlety of what she was doing.
It's fantastic. And in terms of your directing that you've done for Big Finish, you've directed lots. You've directed the 8th Doctor, Time War, the 9th, 10th, 11th and 12th Doctor Chronicles, Lady Christina. Yeah. There were two I specifically wanted to touch on with you, and the first of those was the 8th of March box set, which was released to celebrate the women in the Doctor Who world. Of course, for anyone who doesn't know, the 8th of March is International Women's Day. So how did Big Finish pitch that to you then?
Well, I think they kind of stole the idea that we pitched for Attagirl, in that we wanted to release that on International Women's Day. I think that was Louise's idea, Louise Jameson. And then Big Finish, I think, enjoyed that process, and they thought, well, what can we do for the next International Women's Day? And this seemed very appropriate. But as I always say, I mean, I love that we're celebrating the female characters of Doctor Who, but I really find the debate around, should it be an all-female thing, or, you know, what's the big deal of it being an all-women creative team? And the fact that it is still a big deal is the problem. I would love is for people not to comment on it. So I'd love to get to a point where an all-female team is not a novelty, so that, you know, that people feel the need to comment, oh, it's all women. No, it's irrelevant. The number of all-male over the years.
I remember listening to him on David Tennant's podcast. I think he had Jim Parsons from Big Bang Theory, and he said a similar thing, but in regards to race, how he went into a board meeting for a TV show pitch or something, and he noticed that the person at the head of the table was a person of colour. And he said, you know, his mind immediately thought, oh, wow, that's not something you see every day. And he said, that's part of the problem. He says,
that's the problem.
We need to stop thinking, oh, wow, fancy you getting that position. And I think you're right. It's the same with women. We shouldn't really be going, oh, wow, an all-female creative. How wonderful is that? It should just be.
So what?
Yeah, exactly. But there's some great stories in there. And I think I thought it was just a great release. You know, it was another quality Big Finish box set featuring a ton of talented creatives. But And the other one I wanted to talk about, because this one took me by surprise, I must admit, it was the Rose Tyler Dimension Canon series.
Oh, because, one of my favourites, yeah.
Mine too, because when it was announced, I sort of thought, you know, before you hear anything, your mind goes, how could they make that into a box set, I think was my prevailing thought. And then I gave it a listen, and I was blown away. I loved the sort of, I guess you could say it was a more, would you agree, maybe more like a darker tone than a lot of people were expect it in a positive sense, but I sort of liked how it sort of relished in how they went to these different dimensions and how, you know, in a lot of cases it didn't necessarily end in a happy ending.
Yeah, I think it was very original, the tone of the whole thing, and the fact that it was more about relationships and the emotional journey of characters rather than full-on explosions and running around adventure. It actually wasn't that at all. And it was this wonderful notion of the butterfly effect, isn't it? If I make one choice differently in my life, this is how profoundly differently it could end up. You know, if I didn't cross the street that day, I wouldn't have met so-and-so and my life wouldn't have gone in that direction. And that's what those dimensions show, really, that every little choice matters and has consequences.
And I sort of like how it shows the... I guess the human nature of, especially, you know, Rose and Pete, or all the characters, really, how, you know, we've seen on TV when Rose gets her first taste of a parallel world, she falls for the trappings. You know, she wants to see her dad who's dead in her world. And you'd think maybe going into this, you'd think, right, she's wised up to that now. And they all say, you know, before they jump, they're like, right, you know, no emotional connection, get in, get out. But I think that's just, it's human nature, isn't it? We can't help but form connections with those we feel close to, whether they're different dimension or not. So it was it was nice to explore that.
And to have the cast back again together. I mean, I've worked with Camille Kaduri quite a few times now, and she just never ceases to delight me. Just so giving and kind and, you know, just delightful as an actor as well as a person. But to have, you know, Camille and Billy and Sean all together was like a family reunion. They were all like, oh God, how are you? And it's all very gossipy and excited. And it's just great to be around that.
And I mean, I appreciate your direction and all the creative team's impact on it, because I think I do like it on the occasion where projects in the universe of Doctor Who, if you like, aren't afraid to sort of take that more, as you say, relationship focus, that more real focus, if you like. And, you know, some will say, oh, it's a bit dark. It's like, yeah, well, life's not exactly peachy keen, is it?
So,
and I think I found it a lot more hard hitting now, listening to it now, I guess, you know, because the idea is all these dimensions are folding in on themselves, they're collapsing. And this might sound very melodramatic, but, you know, But
That's what it feels like.
I mean, at the minute, you know, with lockdown and stuff, I think that's why it sort of hit me a bit more, because that sort of overwhelming feeling of everything's closing in and that feeling of you can't really do anything about it. So I think in that sense, relating to Rose a lot more, in that she wants to try and help stop it, but at this point in time, there's nothing she can do.
Have you listened to Time Slip at all? Because that's so prescient. The scripts are just
I haven't as of yet, but I will download it and give that a listen.
Don't feel obliged.
No.
But reading those scripts, I thought, oh God, it paints a horrific future in one in particular, right? Andrew Smith. But then you think, well, these are real issues, and these are potentially real things that could happen, these horrifying I mean, look at what's happened in America. I mean, I don't want to get diverted, but I have been obsessed with it.
Oh, me and you both.
who would have thought I mean, I knew it would happen, but really, who would have thought in this day and age, with all our knowledge, all our access to knowledge, that could still happen?
Absolutely,
it's madness.
And I mean, we are pre-recording this, so this might sound wildly outdated, but today is inauguration day. Hooray.
I'm so happy.
So
I've never been into politics at all. I'm really blissfully ignorant about most of it, but I am an expert on American politics now.
You could deliver a whole TED talk on American politics and how it all works. I've been the same. They somehow find a way, I guess, like a lot of American culture, they somehow find a way to make it feel very, very interesting and almost like a movie. Like, what's the next part? What's going to happen next?
Well, they put movie music behind all their videos. It's all like a movie trailer.
Yeah, like breaking news tonight, yeah.
Yeah.
And one of the other specifically first Doctor Who projects I wanted to touch on briefly was in the Eighth Doctor Time War, the most recent set at the time of recording. You got to tackle, I believe, Davros, the character of Davros,
yes.
who is this, obviously, in the mythos of Who, is this big character with a lot of backstory. So directing Terry Molloy and that character, again, a story where I guess we got expectations subverted. We see different sides of Davros. What was that like for you working on it?
Well, I mean, it was actually quite a diversion, a departure for me. I haven't done a Dalek story before, and I haven't done sort of a full-on proper time war, you know, explosions in space kind of. It felt epic. It's probably the most epic one I've done. And of course, Terry is just, it's legendary, isn't it? When you hear, because in the studio, we do have the sound effect on the voices for when they are playing those characters. So of course, I've got my headphones full of Daleks and Davros. And it doesn't half give you a headache when you're doing that online. And then you have to listen to the edits for hours, you know.
Oh, bless you. You're sick of Dalek voices by then.
Yeah. But I mean, Nick is such a consummate, such a genius at what he does with all those different Dalek characters. And Terry, of course, played the human side of Davros in this very kind of tender way, really. And then this incredible contrast, the slide into psychosis, you know, the psychotic side of Davros. It was done so brilliantly.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's just a pleasure to be around that kind of ability and experience. Yeah.
And I guess, like you say, you forget, especially with Nick Briggs doing the Daleks, because you hear on some of the behind the scenes, you know, you're doing takes and he'll have to retake and he'll do his Dalek voice and then all of a sudden you'll hear, sorry, I got that wrong, let's do it again. So take you out of him and he'll like, oh, what's going on?
And I think in Time War in particular, he had to play lots of different Daleks and, you know, multiple Dalek voices approaching, attack, destroy. And of course, he does it in a different inflection every time. But when you're doing, you pick him up as wild tracks at the end of the scene, and he just does it on his own. Attack, destroy.
The amount of vocal warm-ups that man must do before jumping in the booth.
I don't think he does any.
Really? He's just so used to it now. He can just jump in and do it. Because we've all tried it, you know, we've all tried doing Dalek voices, and I know, like, the amount of warm-up I have to do, because it's just, again, I think people, if you want to go for it, it takes so much of your voice, doesn't it, to really, like, lean into that shouty, screamy, slightly maniacal creature, you know?
We did, when we did the Martian Invasion of Earth, which of course was our version of War of the Worlds, we always, at the end of the day, we save the wild tracks for the end of the day, the death screams, the, you know, attack sounds. And normally it's about half an hour, but we did an hour and a half of death screams and being shot by death rays. And my God, my throat was shredded. I think I was the only woman, the only spare woman. So I had to do all the female death cries.
Bless you. A lot of honey and lemon afterwards, I bet, right?
Yeah. For the bocce, for the bocce.
Oh, yeah. An actor's best remedy, folks. Honey and lemon. Just bit of that down you. Easy.
Yeah.
None of that Strepsil stuff with whatever the chemical is in it. Not good for you. Not good. But talking about Martian Invasion of Earth, that segues nicely. I wanted to talk about... So it's almost like you planned that, Helen. Thank you. Nicely into some... non-Doctor Who productions from Big Finish, if you like, because I often think, you know, as someone who's listened to a lot of audio drama over the years, obviously Doctor Who is Big Finish's biggest stable, but I think sometimes the other projects might get a bit forgotten about or overlooked, and one important project that I am saving up for as we speak, but I wanted to talk about to you a bit, is you mentioned it earlier, Attagirl, which has
had two
box sets. So tell us a bit about that and what sort of prompted that.
Well... it's a funny story, really, because it's Louise's baby.
Yeah.
She had the idea 10 years before and had been wanting to, you know, turn it into a TV script. And then she had the idea, well, let's pitch it to Big Finish. So she spoke to David Richardson, the producer, about it. And then they cornered me on a recording day for something else, said, can we have a word? And they took me into another room and said, right, this is the project and we'd like you to produce it. And I said, oh. Well, I'm not really a producer, you know, I'm the creative one. I'm not someone who likes to do the admin. really. Yeah. And David said, oh, no, it's, you know, you'd have lots of creative input. But he also said, it won't take up much of your time. Which was a lie.
Big old lie.
Oh, big old fat lie. And so they persuaded me to take it on. And actually, yeah, I mean, I loved producing. I loved overseeing the other scripts. I loved co-devising all the storylines. I loved the whole learning process of it. And of course, I co-wrote it and played little parts in the first series and then played quite a big part in the second series. And that's... Yeah. Might seem quite indulgent, but that's a budgetary thing as well. In that, the reason I kind of said, oh, all right, well, we'll do a couple of acting days and we'll, you know, it'll cost slightly less because it's us. And so all that comes into play.
But that's what I mean. You do everything. Producer, I'll do some acting. Oh, I'll do some.
I mean, that. I think of all the projects, Atta Girl is one that I'm most proud of. Because it did nearly kill me. I mean, the amount of research for that was unbelievable.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure. Yeah. If you thought Subterfuge was a lot of research. Then...
Yeah. And I've got slight OCD, and so I have to, it has to be perfect, and it has to be, the timelines have to be correct. Like, at one point we had a script where there was an air raid on the place where the girls were, and I said, well, there just wouldn't have been. I couldn't get over it. I couldn't allow
you couldn't let it slip.
Like
It's funny, isn't it, because different people, I mean, the example I'm thinking of the most recent is the Netflix show The Crown, which of course I suppose for those like me who didn't necessarily grow up in that time, I'm seeing on screen, and I guess you take a lot of it as face value. Oh, that must have happened to a degree. But then you chat with my parents and explain it, and they go, well, that never happened. So yeah, it's that different,
it's
thing, isn't it?
License.
Yeah.
It's so dangerous when you're dealing with real people.
Yes.
There has to be a respect underlying that. And in fact, we made a very deliberate choice. We had one genuine character in it, which was Pauline, the commander of the ATA. And the rest of them were based on, they were characters we'd made up, and they were based on real life characters. Yeah. They were a conglomeration of the real women. Because then it freed us up to have them doing unpleasant things to, you know, to, you just can't do that with a real life character if you've got any kind of ethics. Yeah. I mean, I'm quite ethically conflicted about what they're doing in The Crown. Okay. Yes, it's good drama, but people believe, as you just said, people watch it and think that's exactly what happened. And it's not. And it's not fair on the people that are still living.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of cause for them to put some sort of disclaimer on the beginning saying there's a lot of... I mean, what I did afterwards, after I chatted with my parents, I did some further research and thought, oh, yeah, well, that didn't happen. But of course, not everyone, the casual viewer, might not necessarily do that. And then go around, oh, can you believe what they did back in the day to so-and-so? Yeah. You know, it's...
Well, it's almost like slander, isn't it? It's libelous because it's painting a picture that is not true. And I felt a huge moral responsibility... Because these women were heroes.
Absolutely.
And I felt, you know, morally I couldn't make up stories about them.
And I guess it ties back to what you said about Churchill in Subterfuge. You know, you weren't just going to... yes, you wanted to paint him more realistically, but by the same token, you're not going to make him do something completely that he would never do or didn't do, you know?
Like no.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I suppose you have to within the context of Doctor Who story.
Yeah, like little bits and pieces, but...
Yeah. But yeah, it's a very delicate balance. And we did have actually a member of the public write into us when it was announced we were doing the series. And he was the son of a real ATA pilot. Oh, and he was very upset that, you know, he felt perhaps his mother was going to be written into a dramatic context and that we hadn't consulted with people like him who were clearly experts about it.
Yeah.
And I completely understand that. I wouldn't want someone writing about my father without consulting with me. So, you know, I could reassure him and say, we're not writing specifically about your mother.
No, of course. I mean, I think that's the right way to go, though, as you say, sort of with the ethical mindset, really, because the last thing you should want to do when basing real life is disrespect anyone. So, I think you've gone about it in the right way. And
thank you.
No problem. And you've also starred in The Tomorrow People. As the lead character in that, So was that something, again, Big Finish approached you with, or was it a project you sort of saw and thought, oh, I'd like to get in on that, if you like?
Well, I had to audition for that one. That's the only one I think I auditioned for.
Yeah.
And I think there was discussion around because there are going to be photographs of us on the cover, you know, that came into the casting as well. I going to look right as the character?
It's back to this thing, isn't it? About
which is unusual for an audio drama. So, you know, I was delighted to be part of that. And that went on for 10 years.
It did.
5 series. In fact, we recorded a 6th series and then it was never released because we lost the license.
Oh, man. So it's just a whole new series of it just sitting there on someone's hard drive.
Yes, there is.
Big Finish, if you want to scrape back that license, that'd be great, you know.
There was a whole massive arc, yeah.
Yeah, and the last little Big Finish thing I wanted to touch upon was Phantom of the Opera, which where you played Christine. So, what was that like tackling a very much a classical piece of work in the audio sense, I suppose?
Well, I think my main concern about it was that she was supposed to be 18 and I was in my mid-30s at the time. So I was quite conscious of having to have using the lighter part of my voice. And it was weird to be in something about opera, but obviously I didn't sing the opera bits. They had a proper opera singer do those bits. So that was a bit strange. But yeah, I mean, what a thrill to be part of such a classic story and working with my lovely friend Barnaby again, who's such a genius at what he does. And Tim Sutton again, who I knew from Doctor Who and the Pirates. So it was getting some of the old gang back together again. And
yeah,
in fact, I embarrassed myself. I can't even remember his name. We had an actor in it who I said to him when I came into the green room, I said, "Oh, have we met before? We've worked together before, haven't we?" And then I spent all day saying, "Oh, did I meet you at such and such a place? Could I have met you at the Actors Centre? Oh, have we done role play together?"
Yeah.
And then eventually I said, "Are you famous?" And he said, no, not really. And then later on, I found out he'd played a lead role in Star Trek for years. And
oh, God.
So at the end of the day, I said, when somebody asks you if you're famous, you can legitimately say yes.
Yeah, I'm known by people, you know. Just like,
yes.
Yeah. I think, again, people don't realise in a way, as you say, on one hand, the industry is oversubscribed, but I think it is also such a small world. I mean, I did a workshop with a guy who, like you say, that for like the first hour, I was like, "I know your face." I was like, I know who you are. And he was like, "You seem familiar." And then we clocked he was an old mate at school who moved away when he was 9 and I hadn't seen him for 10 years. And I was like, "What are you doing here?" He's like, "Oh, I'm an actor now." I was like, "So am I." But it's so funny, isn't it? The people you bump into from either times gone by or just, you know, who you don't remember. But
it is a tiny little group of people that get regular work.
Yes.
You know, well, not tiny, but it's a small group of people that are on the circuit, rotating from job to job. And actually, that's really thrown up an issue in lockdown in that those actors who were used to making their living from acting have been in dreadful straits and understandably in a state of terrible distress. But the fact remains, they are the lucky ones, because when it all starts up again, they'll go straight back onto that circuit. And the people out in the wilderness who can't get the auditions, who can't, you know, get seen for the work they want, they'll still be unemployed. They'll still be banging on the door, you know. It's sort of thrown up at the clarity of the great divide. You're very lucky if you're making your living just from acting.
Absolutely. I think
very few people do.
I think I read there was a statistic, I think when I was leaving drama school, you know, again, as you say, preparing for the real world, and I think at that time it was something crazy like 96% of that, or might be even higher, in the 90s% of actors don't make their full living off acting. Which is, you know.
Well, I didn't for years.
Yeah.
I didn't for years.
I still don't now. So.
Well, but, no, I don't. I don't. You know, obviously, I'm a writer and a director.
Of course,
and a singer and and I did role play training. You know, I was a role player and a training consultant and a training designer, you know, behavioral trainer for years and years and years in between acting.
Yeah. Again, I think you sort of have to be though, don't you? Because, you know, especially when you're starting out, and I think it's something they need to drill in more in training, because it was sort of done with us a little bit, but I think not enough, that sort of, you know, you will not walk out of here and be in constant work, even if it's, you know, doing, I don't know, like TIE constantly. It's not a guarantee, and I love TIE. I think that's I think it gets such a stigma to IE. Oh, you're doing schools work. Oh, well, you're not doing a serious job, are you? And it's like, you kidding? Like, this is the future generations here. Like, you know.
Yeah. Well, it's also, I always say now, I wish that I had learned to do plastering, woodwork, hairdressing.
Yeah.
Seriously. No, if you want to be an actor, learn a skill like that. Learn plumbing, learn bricklaying, because those are the jobs you can flex a bit.
Yeah.
You say, I'm a brilliant plasterer and I'll come and do it in one evening because I've got an audition during the day. I would have loved to have learned how to plaster.
It's all these but this is what I think we mean, though, isn't it, about sort of encouraging that for those coming into it, sort of learn as many side skills as you can, not just to necessarily bank it all on the one thing. But obviously you did Phantom. Would you love to give it a crack in the musical version if given the chance?
Well, do you know, I was funny about the mainstream musicals because I was so keen on new writing and repertory theatre and playing different characters within a rep season. And there were quite a few occasions where my agent said, do you want to go for Starlight Express? Do you want to go for Cats? Do you want to go for Les Mis? And I don't think I ever auditioned for Phantom. And it just never appealed to me. I didn't want to step into someone else's shoes. Mm-hmm. That's what it was. I wanted to create the role.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think with new musicals, now with the pandemic, it's harder than ever, isn't it, for new writing to get that showcase. And those that did, even from the bigwigs, what was that, the Andrew Lloyd Webber one a few years ago? Is it Stephen Ward?
Oh, yes, good Lord, yeah. Yes.
And that was only on
a trace, didn't it?
Yeah, it was only on for about 6 months, and that was from Andrew Lloyd Webber, and that couldn't survive. So, if you look at that, you sort of think, what chance does... Joe Bloggs have of writing something,
I'm part of I've taken a break this year, but I have been part of a musical theatre association called Mercury Musicals, Mercury Musical Developments. And they have hundreds and hundreds of members who are all writing new musicals. And I've sort of taken a step back from it because I just think exactly as you just said, it's so hard to get it on. And you might work on a musical for 5 years and then get a 3 month run at a rep. Theatre, if you're lucky, but you're not going to make money from it, and it's not going to have longevity. That it's so rare that you make a living from it, and I'm too old and I don't have time.
You're never too old, Helen. Never too old in this industry.
But... I nearly am too old. Yeah.
It's mad. Just before the pandemic, I was part of a new musical that was going to tour around Yorkshire called No Horizon. And it was about this this real life character called Nicholas Saunderson, who was blind in the 1700s, but he was mathematically gifted and he became a leading professor at Cambridge. And he's got a statue there that you can't see because it's in like a corner of the campus somewhere. And I was going to be playing that role. And, the writer had been writing this since 2003. So this was like 17 years in the making. It was going to tour the northern venues. And then 2 days before opening night, Boris comes on TV.
God.
Yeah, stay away from theatres. And we've had to, unfortunately. Well, it's postponed at the time of recording. We're hoping that maybe end of this year, maybe the start of next. Because all the venues were like, we still want this, which is, great. But I just felt sorry for the writer. Because, after 17 years, you think, I'm finally going to get it performed on a tour. And then... that happens.
Devastating.
So
I know a writer who his show, A Wicker Man, which is a brilliant show, so outstanding.
Yeah.
It had its preview, it had one performance, and then lockdown happened. And they had worked on that for years and years.
But again, what can it was sort of like, what could we do? You can't fight and you want everyone to be safe. It was the right decision. It's just so heartbreaking.
Got but
one of the final things I wanted to ask you, though, Helen, is if you were ever offered the chance to write a script for Doctor Who, the TV show, would you do it?
Hell yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, I had an interesting chat with Nick Briggs and Jason Hay-Gellery about this the other day. And what we realised is that we're very unusual at Big Finish because we are autonomous. We don't have great big authorities giving us the say-so about our scripts. We're basically in a unique position where we can come up with an idea, we can go to Nick or David or Jason and say, here's my idea, do you like it? And they'll say, yes or no,
yeah.
and then you write it, and then they make it.
Yeah.
And for TV, of course, they have got so many people overseeing it and twiddling with it and interfering. So that would be difficult for me. I'm used to being left to do it.
Left to your own devices, someone... sort of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And then obviously we've got editors, amazing editors, who come in and say, no, that needs to change. But oh yeah, I'd love to. I absolutely love to.
And touching on Jodie, of course, who is, I agree with you, doing a fantastic job as our 13th Doctor. As a woman yourself, and as an actor as well, when she was cast, you know, this, again, is it back to this thing we were talking about in the 8th of March? Whilst, you know, everyone's saying, oh, it's the first female doctor. Do you think it shouldn't have necessarily been, like, the driving focus of it, necessarily, or...?
Yes, that's a shame. That was the inevitable, you know, that had to happen, all the politics around it, and the big backlash around it. It's not my show anymore. It's not my doctor. It's like, well...
That's what the mute button on Twitter's for those.
Yeah. I kind of understand it. I do understand that it's a hard leap for some people, but I think it adds so many exciting dimensions to it, and the future is so exciting, because who's going to be next?
Oh, well, exactly. Who knows? So I think my stance has always been like, because a lot of the actors, especially when I was growing up, you know, I didn't know who David Tennant was at 9 years old. I had no preconceptions. And I think that's how I like to go into it a lot of the time, especially if it's an actor I'm not familiar with. It's sort of nice to go, oh, cool, let's just see what they're going to do with it, rather than, well, they did this, this and this, and I didn't like that, which means automatically they must be bad for this. It's like, well, different job's a different job, you know. I mean, it's...
It's all interpretation, isn't it? And interpretations aren't going to be for everyone.
No,
but that is the point of art. I mean, I remember when I started with Big Finish, I had some horrible reviews, fan reviews, for a couple of roles, like real coming up in the first Google search, Helen Goldwyn is terrible in this role. And it doesn't bother me at all, because I think you put yourself out in the public domain, people are absolutely entitled to their opinion.
Yeah.
And if you didn't like that performance, I respect that. That's your opinion.
Yeah.
No, just, that's fair enough. I prefer it didn't come up in the first search.
It'd be like a weird criticism, like, oh, I didn't like the way you died. It's like, okay.
Yeah.
All right, I'll scream differently next time.
But that's the perils of anything in the public domain. It's like if you write something, if some people loathe it and some people love it, that's preferable to everyone going, it's okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's better to provoke strong emotion.
Yeah. So if the inevitable time came, you know, whoever the next person is to take the role, and then Jodie comes to Big Finish, would you be first in line to write a script for her or director?
Oh, gosh, I don't know. Yeah, I'd love to, of course. It's always dependent on what you've got going on at the time. Like, I was asked to write a really exciting script idea for one of the doctors recently, and I thought, well, I just haven't got time to do that. I haven't got time.
Oh, bless you.
Which is a privileged position to be in, of course.
Yeah.
But yeah, let's hope one day,
fingers crossed,
we have that scenario.
Yeah. Because there's no set time to write in these scripts, is there? It's not like, oh yeah, it takes a few hours to bash that out. Like you said with Subterfuge, it could be a fairly quick process or a fairly longer process, depending on say what you're busy with, where you're at in life, or anything, really.
It takes me quite a long time. It takes me longer than most, I think. Hurts my brain, that process.
But you still get them out there, because I mean, I've known from a few friends who have tried to do, you know, fan productions of or fan audio productions, and they said, oh, it took me X amount of years to write it. And I said, oh, is that because you didn't have the idea? They went, no, I always had the idea. But they said writing for audio is a completely different beast compared to writing for anything visual, really.
Yes, yeah, it is. But I think one of the great things that I've experienced is the pressure of a deadline, because actually you can quite easily write 1,000 words a day, and frequently you can write more than that. So if you're writing a 1-hour script, that's 10,000 words. So in theory, you should be able to do that in 2 weeks or less.
There you
go,
folks.
And I have done one in that time,
I wish.
But that's only if you've plotted it out. You have to have your plot beats really so intricately and ready to roll.
I wish I'd heard you say that when I did my dissertation. I tell you what, that would have been so... I did the classic thing of,
a day.
You know, you get like the full year to do it. And I think in September I was like, right, I'll get the first draft by Christmas. Oh, I'll do it by Easter. And then, oh, I've got 1 week left. Right, I should probably start writing this now.
Oh, my God.
But, I mean, doing a dissertation at drama school when you're in, like, 9 till 6 every day, you come in, I'm like, I don't want to write a dissertation. I've been jumping about for 9 hours.
it's very hard, very hard.
Very hard.
I enjoy the fact that I'm allowed to come up into our little bedroom and write all day. Mm. You know, that's my job now.
Yeah.
And
what a joy that must be, you know, just saying, I can just write and that's my job. That's so good.
Yeah, so lucky.
Absolutely. And the last main question I wanted to ask you, Helen, is if out of all the projects you've done, not just Big Finish, I'm talking anything you've ever done, and I know that's a lot, as we've established, that is a lot of stuff. What would you say out of all of that, if you could pick one as like, what's the, I guess the project you've done that made you feel the most proud? Like, you know, the one you'll look back and think, I'm really proud I did that.
I had a musical comedy trio called Ladies Go Diva. Mm. It started out as a one-woman show, and it was songs and lyrics by me. Mm. So it was all written by me. I wrote all the harmonies. I wrote the script. I produced it. I promoted it. I, you know, did everything. And our first big gig was at the English Theatre of Hamburg. Mm. It was the first time we'd really done the show. And people stood and stamped at the end. They stood on their feet and cheered and stamped. Yeah. And it went on for over 10 minutes. It was a stamping ovation. Yeah. And I, in the taxi on the way to the pub afterwards to have a drink, I was crying and crying and crying because it had been such a lot of hard work getting it ready.
Yeah.
But also that feeling of, I knew I was good. I knew I had something special.
Yeah.
I knew it. I told you all for 20 years. I told the industry. They wouldn't listen.
Yeah.
And at that night, I felt resolved. You know, I felt like, oh, it's okay. Yeah. It's okay now. You know, all that frustration has actually led to this. The reason I'm a writer and the reason I'm a composer is because you rejected me. It's because you wouldn't let me in. And so it had to come out in this way. And actually what I've created is better than being in your show.
Hell yeah. I almost want to punch the air hearing that. It's like, yeah, that's right. Big middle finger to the establishment.
Yes.
I like it. And would that sort of be your advice for any young creative of any kind going forward? That thing of sort of, if the establishment doesn't like you, sort of, who cares?
Yes.
Just drive on.
Do your thing. And you've got no excuse not to. I didn't have mobile phones and iPads and internet and, you know, all these platforms when I was starting out, and you have got no excuse not to be writing something, writing monologues, writing sketch shows. If you can't write, find your peers who can, facilitate it, produce it, encourage others, you know, use your creative energy and your creative frustration to become something different and something better. I would not be a full-time creative. I'm in the privileged position of being a writer, director, an actor, a singer, a composer, totally on my own terms, because the industry wouldn't let me in. And I turned all that creative energy into something else. So that is my recommendation. Try your best to create your own work and find your own niche.
I want all of that on a big long poster with you like pointing out like the old World War One, just saying. But I think it is so, you know, it is so important for people to hear that, because the amount of friends I've talked to, younger and older, who sort of feel, you know, the industry for them is demoralizing, you know, because
terrible.
Yeah. So I think we need to hear things like that every now and then, just sort of saying, you know, if the establishment doesn't like you, if you like, then just do it, do it yourself. So.
Yeah, do it your way. I remember chatting to, I'm going to name drop now, I was chatting to Catherine Tate when I recorded The Creeping Death, and she had just finished doing a pilot of something in America, of her own show, and obviously she'd had huge success with her show in the UK, and I said, did you plan any of this? Mm. Did you have like a mood board and vision? She said, no, God, no, you know, should it just, I just said yes to everything and things kind of happened. But of course she was creating her own work.
Yeah.
You know, she was becoming all these things that she knew she had the capacity to become. And so luckily someone else saw the potential of that, but she was doing it herself.
Yeah.
You know,
absolutely.
So yeah, don't let them get you down.
Don't let the bastards get you down. That's the
yeah.
Oh, but Helen, thank you so much for sharing that, and thank you for a lovely hour of conversation as well. I've really, really enjoyed this.
And it's been great to meet you.
And you as well. And before we wrap up, is there any anything you'd like to shout out? Any projects or anything? Feel free to do so.
Well, I think the next thing that's coming out of mine is a primeval design starring Tom Baker.
Oh, yes. Lovely deep voice.
I think I'm the first woman, since we've been talking about this, I'm the first woman to write for the Fourth Doctor.
Wow.
I might be wrong.
I'm trying to... You might be right. I think you're right I know the TV ones,
on the
you're right. Yeah. That's mad. Yeah. It only took, nearly 50 years since he's been on screen?
Yeah. So that was... I'm really proud of that one. That script is epic. Mm. It's an epic tale.
Yeah. Oh, wonderful. Well, guys, check that out. It's all... Everything we've talked about, I believe, is the Big Finish stuff, is on the Big Finish website to download or buy on CD in some form. So you should now just type in Helen Goldwyn on Big Finish, download everything. There is a lot, but download everything and give it a listen. And if you enjoyed this, if you're watching on the YouTube, thank you very much. Please consider subscribing, leaving us a like, all that good stuff. We've got new episodes coming for you every week. And if you're listening on Spotify, all the streaming stuff, I hope you've enjoyed listening. I know I certainly would have done. I'll be listening to this back. I hate the sound of my own voice. But
yay.
If anything to hear that speech at the end, you know, that rousing speech, I love it.
Yeah.
But no, thank you very much to those who are watching and listening. And Helen, once again, thank you so much for joining me today.
My pleasure. It's just lovely to meet you, and well done for what you're creating with this.
Oh, thank you.
This is a creative outlet, and you know, this is all fantastic. Mm. So
I think it's fair to say the creative side of everything has saved me during this last year, as it has a lot of people. Yeah. I think so. Long may that continue. So thank you, Helen, and for everyone watching and listening, I will catch you in the next one.
Bye.